The next item of business is a debate on motion 11874 in the name of Jackie Bailey on ending NHS long waits. I'd be grateful if members wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Jackie Bailey to speak to and move the motion up to 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland saw in the new year with accident and emergency departments in utter disarray as thousands of people, the sick and the injured, experienced long and dangerous waits. Only yesterday we learned that in the first week of 2024, only 59.4% of patients were seen within 4 hours. Indeed, in Glasgow's Queen Elizabeth University Hospital, the figure was 31.1%. Over 1,200 people waiting longer. It may be a new year, but nothing has changed. The crisis in the NHS and social care continues, and the SNP's response, nothing to see here. It's business as usual from the SNP, and the NHS and its hard-working staff remain at breaking point. Almost one in six Scots are stuck on a waiting list. That's 860,000 people. 80,000 are waiting over a year. Now, we all remember Hamza Yousaf's pledge in July 2022 to eliminate completely the longest waits in planned care. Well, let's have a look at how that's going. 2-year waits for outpatients were to be ended by August 2022. Failed. 18 months for outpatients, eliminated by December 2022. Failed. 1-year waits for outpatients, eliminated by March 2023. Failed. And inpatient activity is not much better. 2 years for inpatient waits to be eliminated by September 2022. Guess what? They failed. 18 months for inpatients to be eliminated by September 2023. They failed that one too. And 1 year waits for inpatients will be ended by September 2024. Well, I have to say, Presiding Officer, on the basis of current delivery, I suspect that will be a fail too. Now, I know they don't like hearing it, but the facts are plain for everybody to see. The SNP promised to end long waits, and they failed utterly. And I repeat, we have almost one in six Scots waiting for tests and for treatment. And this has real consequences. I have a constituent who works in theatre at the Golden Jubilee Hospital. She's been on the waiting list for 3 years, but NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde won't let her have her operation at the Jubilee. She is actually assisting people who come from other health board areas that have been waiting as much as a year, but that's 2 years less than her. And she is no further forward. Her knee is now bone on bone. Should she take sick leave from the NHS? Or will you make sure she has her operation, Cabinet Secretary? Because successive SNP health secretaries, Nicola Sturgeon, Hamza Yousaf and Michael Matheson, have simply failed to tackle workforce pressures, and we have 6,700 medical vacancies in our NHS. But we know that the current health secretary is distracted by personal scandals, and he has failed miserably to deliver for the NHS. Take the flagship national treatment centres, the cornerstone of the SNP's NHS recovery plan. Many of these new centres were supposed to clear the waiting list backlog by 2026, but they've been delayed. Some might not even proceed at all. Officials advised Hamza Yousaf against citing figures on the additional capacity that national treatment centres would deliver because, and I quote, projections included in the NHS recovery plan have dropped significantly. The 1,500 additional staff promised by 2026 is unlikely to be met, and some boards are experiencing recruitment challenges in relation to staffing. A Cabinet Secretary briefing from the 8th of March 2023 revealed that there was no, and I quote, no revenue funding source for the national treatment centres that are not yet in construction, whilst, and I quote again, the remaining programme is not affordable on the basis of the current capital spending review. National treatment centres delayed in NHS Grampian, in Tayside, and NHS Lanarkshire and NHS Ayrshire and Arran don't even have the full business case required to get the process started. And what about the Edinburgh Eye Pavilion too? Now, the SNP won't tell us what will be ditched until March or possibly May because they don't want scrutiny of the capital programme alongside the budget. The truth is that these centres will not be delivered on time, and some might not be delivered at all. The SNP's recovery plan is simply not worth the paper it's written on. All we have are yet more broken promises from a party that has run out of ideas. The Scottish Government is always keen to blame the pandemic. And of course the pandemic happened. But the truth is that the NHS was in crisis long before COVID-19. And finally, Presiding Officer, let me address the SNP's latest promise on extra investment. Now, we heard from the Cabinet Secretary that they're going to reduce waiting lists by 100,000 in 2 years' time. Well, firstly, what happens to the other 700,000 people waiting? But many patients and NHS staff will rightly ask why they should have any faith left in this government after all its previous broken promises. But secondly, let me tell you how it's being paid for. Because the SNP assume that there will be a Labour government in Westminster that delivers extra NHS funding to Scotland. Yes, Presiding Officer, that's right. Even this SNP government know that we need a UK Labour government for their plans to come to fruition. The people of Scotland have been left high and dry by an SNP government marred in scandal after scandal and more interested in playing fantasy politics than dealing with the crisis in our NHS. Enough is enough. The SNP government must prioritise tackling the NHS crisis before more lives are lost.
Could I just ask Ms Bailey to move the motion?
I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Michael Matheson to speak to and move Amendment 11874.2. Up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a government, we remain focused on ensuring our health service continues to recover from the long-term effects of the pandemic. Scotland is not unique in facing these challenges as services across the UK continue to be challenged. Too many people are waiting too long for treatment, and I'm committed to delivering sustained improvements and reducing waiting times year on year across our NHS. That's why in our draft budget we've provided funding of over £19.5 billion for health and social care, giving our NHS a real terms uplift, which is in stark contrast to the UK Government's autumn statement that shows a real terms cut to NHS England. Even in the face of unprecedented pressures, we continue to see progress following the introduction of our long wait targets. We've seen a substantive reduction in new outpatient waits over 2 years since the targets were announced, with 85% of specialities having fewer than 10 waits. The number of waits over, if you may allow me to make progress first of all, the number of waits over 78 weeks reduced by 30.1% as of September last year, and 34% of specialities had fewer than 10 patients waiting over 52 weeks. And waits of over 2 years for inpatient day case treatments have also reduced by some 26% since the target was introduced. And with the thanks of hard-working staff and our NHS boards, we have seen a further increase in activity, with the latest statistics showing activity in inpatient and day cases at the highest level since the start of the pandemic. I'll give way to Jackie Bailey.
Jackie Bailey.
Isn't it the case that you actually promised to end these waits, not simply just reduce them, and by your own measure, you have failed?
Always through the chair, Cabinet Secretary.
The reality is, Presiding Officer, as I set out, we're making very substantial progress, but clearly more needs to be done, and we're determined to do that. And I know that challenges remain, and there are still unacceptable waits for some specialities. And that's why we're committed to enhancing both regional and national working to develop national solutions to create a sustainable service to reduce backlogs, focusing on those specialities where there are significant pressures. This is supported by our National Treatment Centre programme. We've opened two NTCs last year, one in Fife and the other in NHS Highland, with a further two centres opening in the coming months in Forth Valley and also at the Golden Jubilee Hospital. Signed officer, central to all of this is our £1 billion of recovery NHS recovery plan. Our second annual progress update, published on the 6th of December, demonstrates the improvements that are being taken forward as a result of our significant investment, delivering targeted reform and also dedicated innovation. So, for example, since 2021, I need to make progress just given a limited time, I'm afraid. We've already invested some £8.6 million in programmes through the Centre for Sustainable Delivery to help to support transformation and the rollout of new techniques, innovation and safe, fast, efficient pathways for Scotland's patients. And it's crucial that we secure best value wherever we are delivering services in NHS Scotland, allowing us to maximise the impact of our investment and the delivery of quality services to patients. Of course, none of this would be possible without the dedicated staff within NHS Scotland. NHS staff levels are historically high under this government, with over 24% more in post, and we remain committed to implementing our national strategy. And due to our constructive engagement with trade unions, Scotland is the only part of the UK not experiencing strike action in our NHS. I am somewhat surprised that Labour are bringing forward this debate in the very same week when junior doctors are striking in Labour-run Wales, resulting in the cancellation of 6,500 outpatient appointments and some 400 planned operations, which will undoubtedly impact on their own waiting times. And of course, that's dwarfed by NHS England, where a total of 1.3 million acute inpatient and outpatient appointments have been cancelled due to strike action in England since December 2022. Signed officer, as a government, we'll continue to make progress, and I'm determined to see continued improvements over the course of the coming year. I'm committed to making sure we take forward the changes to deliver a recovery and also to reform the way in which we deliver services within NHS Scotland to deliver a sustainable healthcare system to continue to deliver high-quality services to the patients of Scotland.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. If I could just ask you to move the amendment.
Happy to move.
Thank you. I now call on Sandesh Gulhani to speak to and move Amendment 11874.1. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. I wish to draw members' attention to my register of interest as a practising NHS GP. Well, there you heard it. Everything's fine here. There's no problem. The Cabinet Secretary says our health service is rosy. Well, in December 2023, only 66% of patients at A&E were seen within 4 hours. Between July and September 2023, only 72% of cancer patients began treatment within the statutory 62 days of an urgent referral. Another month, another set of dismal data. Another quarter, more failure. We're sounding like a broken record, but the SNP just doesn't seem to care. It takes no responsibility, safe in the knowledge that the Scottish Greens have their backs for the price of two ministerial limos. So maybe we should stop talking about stats and percentages and instead highlight what really matters, people's lives. According to the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, in 2023, there were 1,400 extra avoidable deaths that were linked to long A&E wait times. 1,400 people. People, not numbers on a spreadsheet. Now, I want to be crystal clear. Nobody is criticising our frontline staff. They go far and above their call of duty. But this incompetent SNP government have left healthcare in Scotland on its knees. And Humza Yousaf, Michael Matheson, one health minister after another have offered no solutions. Scotland needs and deserves a fresh approach to deliver a modern, efficient and local NHS accessible to all. But instead, the SNP has dithered and watched Scotland's GP workforce shrink. Presiding officer, Scotland has had enough of the SNP playbook. The First Minister or the Cabinet Secretary comes to a chamber, makes an announcement, fails to deliver, then defends their record by tripping out spin and promising lessons will be learnt. Let's take access to child and adolescent mental health services, CAMHS. Humza Yousaf promised to clear CAMHS waiting lists by March 2023. Yet by September 2023, over 5,000 children were still waiting to start treatment. One child waiting 37 weeks in Glasgow, with some having waited a year in Lothian. Sergeant Officer, this matters because poor mental health robs our kids of their childhood. I will.
Rachel Hamilton.
Young people and young adults have to wait 39 weeks for the first appointment for treatment for CAMHS treatment. And I just think that the government should actually apologise for this appalling lack of support to young people.
Sandesh Gulhani.
I couldn't agree more. Our kids are suffering and they are not being looked after by our SNP government. Let's look at NHS estate. The SNP's manifesto pledged to invest £10 billion over a decade to renew our NHS estate. Yet today we hear all NHS projects have been halted for at least 2 years, even affecting the SNP solution to waiting lists, the National Treatment Centres. And I'd like to close with another SNP failure, the worst drugs-related deaths in Europe. Look, I'll leave the matter of hunting down those who profit from the criminal trade in this misery to Police Scotland. Drug dealers are criminals, gangsters. But we can bring the SNP to book for cutting the funding to drug and alcohol recovery services by £19 million. People addicted to drugs and alcohol deserve and desperately need our help. They should have a right to recovery. Presiding officer, it's only our frontline NHS workers that are preventing Scotland's health service from keeling over. On this SNP's watch, the same party that's been in charge of health since 2007 and has failed to pass on £18 billion in health consequentials in that time, we see the results. The SNP is responsible. No ifs, no buts. Thank you. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to Jackie Bailey for bringing this motion to Parliament today. Before I begin my remarks, can I congratulate her on her investiture as a dame this afternoon at the Palace, getting an honour for politics and up all the right people's noses, I think. Here we are again, Presiding Officer. The facts laid out in the motion for today's debate make grim reading indeed, and they're no stranger to any of us or our casework post bags. Almost one in six people in Scotland are currently on NHS waiting lists for either tests or treatment. 80,000 people are currently waiting over a year, 365 days, to be seen. People are dying because they're waiting too long for emergency care. And just yesterday, A&E waiting times figures were released, and they are equal to the record-breaking figures of last year. Things just aren't getting any better. And whether they are forced to wait hours for an ambulance to be seen in A&E or left abandoned on trolleys or languishing on wards, people are being let down. And it's not just on the front line these problems are manifest, but right across our health service in its entirety. Take diabetes as an example. Currently, only 18% of people living with diabetes in Scotland are receiving the essential health checks, the regular health checks that they need. That's down from 40% pre-pandemic, which is still well behind where it should have been. I have lost count of the number of times that we've had debates like this in this chamber. We keep having them, and usually just in opposition time. I fear we've become inured to that. We've got used to our health service languishing and struggling in the way that it has, and we have become dangerously comfortable with crisis. Because every time we raise it in this place, ministers refer to the pandemic. Presiding officer, every time they do so, they insult the intelligence of us all here, those people watching, and they seriously test the patience of the hard-working staff on which we rely. The issues in our NHS were there long before anyone had heard of COVID-19, and people are tired of those excuses. They are tired of the ministerial disinterest and mismanagement that have defined this SNP and Green administration's approach to health. And, Presiding Officer, I want to be crystal clear, none of this is the fault of our hardworking staff. They've worked their fingers to the bone. They've worked miracles and spin gold out of straw. They worked long hours under the most stressful circumstances imaginable, and they deserve our utmost thanks. But they are being let down as well. There are currently almost 6,800 NHS workforce vacancies unfilled. That puts enormous, untold strain on the staff who are there. And the chair of BMA Scotland has said, and I quote, doctors and other healthcare workers are exhausted and facing burnout under these increasing workloads. SNP Green Government decisions have compounded the pressures on nursing staff. And that problem stretches all the way back to Nicola Sturgeon cutting nursing and midwifery training places and claiming at the time that it was, and I quote, the sensible thing to do. The Health Secretary has shown zero sign of innovative thinking necessary to resolve this issue. And when Humza Yousaf was in his position, he repeatedly ignored my party's call for a plan to address staff burnout and to set up a health and social care staff assembly. This government have shown a pig-headed contempt for a strategy that would guarantee annual leave, ensure safe staffing levels, and champion the expertise of those who know our health service best. It's little wonder, then, that we are now finding it harder than ever to attract and to retain new staff. On this government's watch, costs for temporary staff have risen to over £500 million in recent years. Rather than making the meaningful investment our health service needs, this government is relying on short-term fixes to plug the gaps. Presiding officer, to put it plainly, this government is failing. It is failing Scotland's NHS, both the hard-working staff who run it and the patients who depend on it. Both staff and patients alike need long-term solutions. They need new hope. And the Health Secretary needs to do three things. I'll close with these. He needs to urgently draft his failing recovery plan, give hard-working staff the fair paying conditions they deserve, and fix the issues in social care so that people can be treated in the community rather than being left to languish on hospital wards well enough to go home, but too frail to do so without a viable care package. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to the open debate, and I call Carol Mockin to be followed by Claire Hawley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This issue is perhaps the one I hear most about from constituents across south of Scotland, and that's why it is essential it is given fair hearing here in the Chamber today. Whether they live in rural or urban areas, if they are young or old, if they have a long-term condition or seek new advice, worries about NHS waiting times are a constant. Not just waiting, but it's described to me as languishing on NHS waiting lists. That's not me describing this, it's patients, constituents in all of our communities. And I expect every one of us here has or knows someone waiting, experiencing this. Put simply, our constituents want to know what can be done to avoid, to stop our NHS being under such constant pressure. And though they are sympathetic that waiting times are a reality of any health service, some of the extended waits people are having to put up with are simply unheard of. 7,000 Scots waiting over 2 years. And I wasn't going to bring this up, but in the Cabinet Secretary's contribution, he kept referring to other nations. You know, 7,000 Scots over 2 years, and in England it's 227. It's not helpful to continue to go over these figures. People want to know what is happening. In Scotland, it really is at the point where it's become commonly accepted that there are certain operations and treatments you will have to wait potentially years for. And in some cases, that can shorten lives and cause unmanageable stress. Is that really what we came to this place to do? As lawmakers, as elected representatives of our communities, we have to understand the people telling us this are not just statistics moving from one column to another. They're real people with complex lives that are in constant limbo because they simply do not know when they will receive the treatment they require. Under this SNP government, we've heard 80,000 people and their loved ones are living with anxiety and in many cases pain for over a year waiting for planned care because this government are not getting it right. These people view commitments made by the government as a personal promise, and time again they're seeing that it amounts to just words. I do not think that it is acceptable, and I implore those with the power to change the trajectory to not treat this in terms of look over there, it's someone else's fault, or we're not as bad as someone else. I don't think that does justice to our constituents. Do look at the long-term plan, the long-term investment and infrastructure needs of the NHS in Scotland. Be honest about delays on national treatment centres. Reset the programme clearly. You only mentioned a couple, Cabinet Secretary, you only mentioned a couple of the national treatment centres and didn't speak about some of the other projected centres. We also need to acknowledge that we require to ensure that our workforce is secure and that we move away from the damaging and expensive reliance on agency workforce. This has been a thing of this SNP government and they need to address it. It's our job here to hold you to account and I ask you to address this. I have sympathy for any government who has to put up with the constant undercutting of public services led by the Conservative government in Westminster, but our job in this place is to deal with what we can do, and this government can do things. So, on behalf of my constituents, I say, let's be clear about what can be done. This government has been in power for 17 years, delivering promises made around staffing and national treatment centres. There is a staffing crisis which is making commitments like the National Treatment Centre impossible to deliver. We must do what we can, and I ask the Cabinet Secretary to take this. This is a genuine request to feedback appropriately on this so that we can feed this into our communities and our constituents. Cabinet Secretary, let's push forward into the new year with a serious plan, not yet more empty promises. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Claire Haughey to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my entry in the Register of Interests. I hold a bank nurse contract with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And as someone who continues to work proudly in our NHS, I'm under no illusions of the challenges that it currently faces. In the years ahead, these challenges will become more pronounced with demographic changes and the expected increase in disease burden. It's therefore abundantly clear that significant investment in our NHS and indeed reform of the delivery of care is of paramount importance. In the face of Tory austerity, their shameful autumn statement and their mishandling of the economy, which has caused inflation to run rampant, this SNP Scottish Government is taking the necessary decisions to ensure continued investment in health and social care services. In the draft budget, the Deputy First Minister announced an increase of over £550 million to NHS frontline boards, a 4.3% uplift, taking the total investment to over £13.2 billion. Scottish Government funding of the NHS has ensured record high staffing levels. It will drive forward work to increase health service capacity, including through a network of national treatment centres, and it will reduce backlogs, delivering year-on-year reductions in waiting lists. And on that last point, yes, of course, too many people have waited too long for treatment. However, I do welcome that we've seen a significant reduction in the longest waits since the targets were announced last July. And this includes a 69% reduction in patients waiting over 2 years for a new outpatient appointment from the end of June 2022. And there's also been a 26% reduction in patients waiting longer than 2 years for inpatient or day case treatment since the targets were announced. This is welcome progress, but we know there is still more to do. Presiding Officer, Scottish Labour never want to talk about the significant and ongoing impact that COVID has on our health service, notably in the area of planned care, as well as other external factors. And they should listen to the Welsh Government's Minister for Health and Social Services, who said only in the last week, and I quote, "The pressures on the NHS are unrelenting in every part of the UK. Over the last 13 years, the NHS, like other public services, have had to contend with austerity, the impact of a botched Brexit, the pandemic, record levels of inflation and rising demand. It is not difficult to work out why it is so challenged across the whole of the UK. And it's also worth noting that we are sitting in this chamber today. While we're here, junior doctors are currently striking in Wales, where Labour is in power. The NHS is nothing without its dedicated workforce, and I'm proud that due to the value this SNP government places on our health staff, Scotland remains the only country in the UK to have been successful in averting NHS strikes. And in doing so, we've avoided the knock-on effect this would have on capacity and on postponed operations and outpatient appointments. That was looking at Wales, where Labour are in power. But even looking at Westminster, where in opposition, it's clear Labour don't have the plans or the ambition to tackle the challenges facing health services across the UK. Labour's Shadow Health Secretary said that a UK Labour government would hold the door wide open to private sector involvement in the NHS, and also stated that he didn't think it's good enough that the NHS uses every winter crisis and every challenge it faces as an excuse to ask for more money. Hardly supportive of the hard-working staff that we hear faint praise for from across these opposition benches. Labour's only plan for our NHS seems to be opening up to the private sector involvement, starving it of much needed investment, supporting a Brexit which impacts on recruitment of health and social care staff, and undervaluing NHS staff, leading to strikes. Presiding officer, this Scottish Government remains committed to driving down waiting times, particularly for those waiting the longest for treatment. We're resolute in doing what we can to support our workforce through record levels of staff, promoting their wellbeing, and protecting and providing proper pay increase, and absolutely committed to keeping our NHS publicly owned, private, with no private involvement,
you must conclude,
and at the point of need.
Thank you. I call Colin Smith to be followed by Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Once again, it was the pandemic that did it, is the sole reason we've heard from the Cabinet Secretary for the crisis engulfing our health and social care services. It's a damning admission that 2 years on, Hamza Yousaf's recovery plan is failing, but it also defies the reality that the seeds for this crisis were sown well before 2020. Pre-pandemic, the Scottish Government received warning after warning, alarm after alarm sounded about the risk to patients of the systematic underfunding, of the absence of proper workforce planning, of the lack of any clear plan for our health and social care services. As far back as 2017, the British Medical Association warned the National Health Service was at breaking point, and the failure to listen to those warnings, to act, this incompetence has consequences for patients and for staff. A day rarely goes by when constituents don't share heartbreaking stories showing just how broken services are. A year ago in this chamber, I told the story of Pat, who was receiving palliative care after a cancer diagnosis. Pat's wish was to spend what time she had left at home. Her care needs were, of course, increasing, but that wish was not too much to ask. An assessment was made, a care package agreed, but there were no carers to deliver it. Marie Curie did what they could, as did the family, but the growing burden on Pat's husband became too much. He was admitted to hospital, and tragically, that's where he remains. There were still no carers to take over, so Pat was also admitted to hospital, even though she was not receiving any medical treatment and could and should have been cared for at home. Pat sadly died in hospital. Since then, things have got worse. I could share more tragic cases from my inbox. Constituents being placed in care homes from hospital to fiddle the delayed discharge figures, often for months, often miles from their families, waiting to go home where they should be. Operations routinely cancelled because beds are unnecessarily full due to delayed discharge. Jackie Bailey listed many of this government's broken promises on health. Here's another one. 9 years ago, the SNP pledged to eradicate delayed discharge within a year. Today, it has spiralled out of control. It's draining £1.2 billion over the last decade from our NHS. In Dumfries and Galloway alone, between 2015 and 2023, that bill was a staggering £40 million, money we could have been using to pay carers a proper wage. And, Presiding Officer, no service, no constituent in my region has been left untouched by the crisis engulfing health and social care. Care homes have closed, community hospitals have closed, GP surgeries have closed, dentists have closed. Indeed, more than 20,000 patients in Dumfries and Galloway alone have been deregistered from the NHS recently. You cannot register with a single NHS dentist in that region. There's no waiting list because there is nobody to register with on a waiting list. We've heard increasing concerns that the NHS is unsustainable in its current form. The reality is, it's this Scottish Government's negligence that's unsustainable. Their failure to take responsibility, to act decisively, is a real threat to the future of our National Health Service. We need the Government to stop ignoring the warnings, to finally make good on their promise to eradicate delayed discharge. We need a long-term plan to tackle the low level of sheltered housing and the loss of care homes locally, and we need the Government to pay our care workers properly. At a time the national minimum wage will rise to £11.45 per hour from April, the Government's pledge to pay carers just 56p more will make little difference to filling vacancies. But listening to the calls from unions, listening to the calls from Labour to pay care workers a fair wage with a clear timescale to move towards £15 per hour and proper career progression would help with the recruitment crisis. It would free up hospital beds and ultimately it would reduce the long waits for treatment. Presiding officer, that's the least patients and our dedicated, hard-working staff deserve.
Thank you. I call Annie Wells to be followed by Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all admire the dedication and hard work of NHS staff. Whatever help we need, they go to incredible lengths to keep us healthy. We owe them our thanks for the work that they do. But despite the amazing efforts of NHS staff, Scotland's health service is in crisis. Staff have been let down by the lack of support from the SNP government. Systemic problems in our NHS have driven excellent nurses and doctors to breaking point. And no matter how hard they work, they cannot give every patient the care they deserve anymore. This presiding offers the grim reality of Scotland's NHS under the SNP's leadership. There is a crisis at practically every level of the NHS. Years of subpar plans from the SNP, including Hamza Yousaf's flimsy NHS recovery plan, has seen the situation in our NHS spiral out of control. The SNP will blame the pandemic, but the reality is that most of these problems were already apparent before COVID. The pandemic only made them worse. Here's the situation right now in the NHS. Waiting times for A&E have hit the record worst ever levels. The treatment time target for A&E is 4 hours, but since this session of Parliament began, that target has been missed over a million times. And this doesn't just inconvenience people, it costs lives. Last year, the Royal College of Emergency Medicine said one extra death occurs for every 72 patients that wait over 8 hours in A&E. Based on those figures, just to the end of September last year, more than 1,400 people lost their lives because of A&E waiting times. The problems at A&E have sent the ambulance service into crisis too. Ambulances are regularly forced to queue for hours outside hospitals before they can admit a patient and get back out on the road. The consequence is people waiting absurdly long times for ambulances, even up to as much as 15 hours. But the issues don't end there. People are often leaving treatment until it becomes an emergency and they need to attend A&E or get an ambulance because they've not been able to get a GP appointment. They can't get an appointment quickly because there are simply not enough GPs. The SNP's poor workforce planning has left GPs struggling to meet demand. The British Medical Association say we need another 1,000 GPs to plug gaps. The SNP promised to increase GP numbers, but they're going in the wrong direction. And that's not the only broken promise from the SNP and Scotland's NHS. Maybe the most damaging one was their failure to end delayed discharge, which the Deputy First Minister said they would do 9 years ago. The consequences of failing to meet that promise have been huge. Almost 2,000 beds are occupied every day due to delayed discharge. Neither is the SNP's failure to recruit more GPs the only serious workforce issue in Scotland's NHS. Spending on agency staff has quadrupled in 2 years. There are over 5,000 nursing vacancies in NHS Scotland, and staff turnover is at its highest rate in a decade. I don't have time, I've got a lot to do, and I'm in my last minute. The consequences of these systemic problems is that our excellent NHS staff can't deliver the care that they want to, and patients are left waiting days, weeks, months, and sometimes even years for the treatment that they need. Because one thing is certain, Presiding Officer, the crisis in our NHS cannot go on like this, and our vision is for a modern, efficient, local Scottish health service accessible to all. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Ivan McKee to be followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to speak in this albeit very short debate on Scotland's health service. I think it's important to recognise at the outset the challenges we face, but also the successes that have been delivered in the work that's ongoing. And the Cabinet Secretary has outlined a number of those, including the fact that Scotland is the only part of the UK that's avoided strikes in our NHS. Of course, the service faces challenges, not least from an ageing population, health inflation, the impact of Brexit on workforce availability and many, many others. I think it's important to use the short time we have available, not as the opposition are doing, just to throw out random talking points into the debate, but to have clear proposals that we can take forward to it to make some specific improvements in addition to the work that's already happening. So in the short time I have available, I just want to focus on a few of those. First of all, round about the adoption of technology, including process improvement, leveraging the great work of Scotland's fabulous life science sector. Some examples: we only have 1.5% of operations across Scotland's NHS delivered by robotics, something where higher quality and increased efficiency can be delivered. And I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to look more thoroughly at that. Use of artificial intelligence in, for example, radiography. Use of sensor technology, for example, in falls monitoring and prevention. Use of increased digitisation, leveraging Scotland's great expertise in that sector, in booking systems, digital dentistry and many, many others. And I'd like to pay tribute to the work of the Accelerated National Innovation Adoption Pathway, ANIA, and the great work that's been taken forward there, but there's so much more that can be done in that space. Secondly, the rollout of that technology and best practice right across the health service and all health boards across the country, and that Once for Scotland process. And I know that there's work happening there, but I would ask the Government to do some evaluation of the potential savings and improvements that could be made of best practice in each health board was adopted across all health boards. Thirdly, in terms of shifting resources, and it was good to have a conversation and an evidence session from the Cabinet Secretary at the Health Committee on this yesterday. We know that cure is significantly cheaper than prevention, working on the Christie principles, and it would be great to see more happening in that space. We know that there has to be a shift from management layers towards the front line, and from high-cost interventions to lower-cost ones. So again, I would ask the Government to take forward some work in detail to help us understand how we can better measure the resources that are applied in each of those areas, and get under the skin of the health board budget so that we know what the potential savings and improvement are by moving towards a more frontline focused service, focused more on cure, more on prevention rather than downstream cure. The next area is round about structures, and I think a big bang solution is time-consuming and it's expensive, but I don't doubt that there are many opportunities to remove duplication of services between health boards in terms of back-office management and administration and bureaucracy, and for ever closer working together of health boards, and looking for opportunities for consolidation where that makes sense, to be able to take out costs from the back-office and reapply them to the frontline services. And I would also ask that the single authority model is given some more serious attention in certain areas of the country. I know that this is very favoured, and particularly in smaller local authorities, allows for a much more efficient service delivery model. And looking to join the dots where possible and making it easier. The example of community link workers in one constituency in Glasgow recently, where different parts of the system were unable to agree to continue to fund that very cost-effective intervention until the Cabinet Secretary stepped in to make that happen. And just finally, in concluding, Presiding Officer, very important to recognise the Government's absolute commitment to the fundamental principles of the health service. Public provided services free at the point of use, and of course resist all efforts towards privatisation of the service, as has unfortunately happened in other parts of the UK. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Jamie Green to be followed by Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I congratulate Dame Jackie Bailey on her honours today? I'm disappointed she didn't wear that hat to the chamber. Listening to today's debate, when opposition parties debate those great pillars of devolved government, health and education, as we've done so well today, I think they generally do so for good reason. These debates are often backed up with statistics and facts, often informed by stakeholder evidence. They're not talking points, I'd say gently to Mr. McKee, they're facts, and they're worth debating in this chamber, because the government's response to these debates is predictable. Little sign of contrition or acceptance of any of the criticism directed towards it, a denial of the scale or extent of the problems that we face, and a huge amount of whataboutery, as we've heard from the minister. Today's debate is a fine example of that. Labour rightly pointed out today that 80,000 people have waited over a year for planned care. They rightly raise the years of missed targets, the growing workforce problems faced. On our benches, we highlighted the worrying cuts to drug and alcohol services, and we raised the plight of the 1 million people who have waited over 4 hours at A&E since 2021. The Lib Dems raised issues around NHS staff themselves, who, of course, are at the core of these debates, and the Greens, well, they didn't even bother to turn up this afternoon. That says so much. The government's feeble amendment, and it is a feeble amendment, immediately, in the first opening line, removes the word alarmed from it, because they clearly are not as alarmed as we are, or indeed as our constituents are. They go as far as congratulating themselves because fewer patients are waiting over 2 years for an appointment to be seen. Their amendment removes all references to the drug and alcohol deaths, removes references to A&E waiting times, to mental health waiting times, and frankly, anything else which seems to embarrass them. In fact, their only defence in their amendment today is that all devolved policymakers seem to be doing a terrible job at managing health. So it's all relative, I suppose, mediocrity at its very worst, presiding officer. The bad news is far too often buried away. It is not publicly available. For example, in researching this debate, audiology waiting times could not be found because apparently, from an FOI response, we learn that this data is not published following agreement with the Scottish Government. What a surprise. Speech therapy figures were released yesterday, not by the government, but by the Royal College of Speech and Language Therapists. Again, they had to FOI the data. And from that data, we discover that 6,500 children in Scotland are currently on a waiting list for their first appointment. It's shocking, and I've raised this issue because in my area they actually closed the waiting list. It was over 2 years long. It's despicable. What about mental health waiting times? One patient in Ayrshire and Arran waited 91 weeks for their first CAMHS appointment. Can you imagine that? We only know that because we FOI'd it. We only know that because we asked written questions. We never hear it from the government, and we certainly never hear it in their debates. The amendment from the government today is just sheer brass neck, I'm afraid, because we've heard repeated parroting today that the NHS in Scotland is free at the point of need. Well, here's a reality check. If you want to see a dentist this week in Greenock and you pick up the phone, the only appointment you will get, Cabinet Secretary, is if you offer to pay for one. That's the reality of the NHS in Scotland. The same goes if you want a hearing aid. The same goes if you're desperate for a knee or a hip replacement. You have to borrow the money, cash in your savings, go abroad, or go private. That is the reality of the health service today in 2024. Presiding officer, with their amendment, the only people the government are fooling are themselves. Fixing the problem requires admittance that there is a problem. It's not creeping privatisation that we need to be worrying about, it's creeping ineptitude in government. And let me tell you, there's plenty of it going around.
Thank you. I call Bob Doris, the final speaker in the open debate.
Presiding officer, with regards to this afternoon's debate on the NHS in Scotland, it's worth observing that the substantive motion before us from the Labour Party offers not a single new idea or initiative for what Labour in Scotland would do differently to improve Scotland's NHS, nor does it identify a single additional penny for Scotland's NHS. I acknowledge the Scottish Government amendment recognises that health services across the UK are dealing with the long-term effects of COVID-19 pandemics on waiting times, and further recognises that too many people are waiting too long for treatment. Of course, despite some improvements, that includes right here in Scotland. I readily acknowledge we all wish to see those improvements gather pace. The Labour motion mentions long-term waits in particular within the NHS. Stephanie Howarth, the Chief Statistician to the Welsh Government in September 2023, sought to analyse long-term waits across all UK nations. Ms Howarth indicates that for treatment pathways waiting for more than 1 year in Wales in March 2023, that was 133,000 people. The figure in Scotland was 74,000. For 2 years in Wales, it was 28,000. In Scotland, it was 8,000. Now, I also acknowledge, Ms Howarth goes on to state, that although we know these figures aren't entirely equivalent to each other and should not be directly compared, and that's not what I'm doing, Presiding Officer, the methodological differences cannot account for the scale of some of the differences in the numbers waiting longer than 1 or 2 years. This suggests more impactful progress in Scotland on this occasion than elsewhere. That won't always be the case, so can I ask the Scottish Government how we share such practices across the UK to share best practice and how we receive it from elsewhere. I commend health and social care workers, not only in Scotland, but right across the UK, actually. We need to set the challenges facing Scotland in a pan-UK context, even where that is uncomfortable for Labour, when it includes NHS performance in Wales. Presiding officer, given the spending plans of the UK Government would see only an additional £10 million increase to Scotland's budget, and something we have to acknowledge the UK Labour Party has not deviated from. Thank heavens our Scottish Government will increase the spend to our NHS by over half £1 billion. I acknowledge vacancy levels and recruitment remain significant challenges. Again, such challenges are faced right across the UK. That's understandable given the impact of Brexit has undermined workforce planning right across the UK. Indeed, the Nuffield Trust research indicated that there are 4,000 less European doctors working in the NHS because of Brexit. And the NMC estimated in 2022 there are now up to 58,000 fewer European nurses across the UK compared to pre-Brexit trends. That's a reality. Yet the Labour motion mentioning recruitment challenges makes absolutely no reference of Brexit. It doesn't have credibility. But of course it doesn't. It doesn't suit their agenda. And after all, Labour are a pro-Brexit party, something they don't like drawing attention to here in Scotland. Yep. I suspect that what will help Scotland's NHS recruitment challenges, however, is the fact that NHS workers in Scotland are the best paid and best supported than anywhere else in the UK. Now, I'm aware of various recruitment initiatives the Scottish Government has taken forward to tackle staff vacancies, because there are challenges, very real challenges, but can I ask whether that includes attracting, unfortunately within the confines of Brexit Britain, many of those EU healthcare professionals that have chosen not to work in Britain as a direct consequence of Brexit. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I absolutely acknowledge the significant and enduring challenges of Scotland's NHS, indeed in healthcare systems right across the UK. Unfortunately, Labour set today's terms of reference with this debate, and they pursued cynical political opportunism rather than constructive dialogue. I look forward to the next debate. I hope they do much better.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Tess White. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The complacency of this SNP government as the NHS spirals is staggering. As we've heard this afternoon, from waiting times to workforce planning, the NHS is in crisis. National treatment centres were touted by Humza Yousaf as the cure-all for capacity problems. But now the SNP has hit the brakes on NHS capital projects. You just couldn't make it up. Almost 830,000 patients are on an NHS waiting list, a figure that's barely believable. A patient in Tayside waited almost 4.5 years for orthopaedic surgery. Another in Grampian waited 3 years and 179 days for cataract surgery. The impact on patient treatment and staff morale is profound, and there's no end in sight. The beleaguered health secretary has been distracted and more preoccupied with saving his own job than plugging the gaps in NHS vacancies. Jackie Bailey highlighted promises made by this SNP Green government, such as their promise to eliminate completely longest waits in planned care. She gave them a fail, 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 fail. And she said that Michael Matheson was distracted by personal scandals. Michael Matheson apologised for the unacceptable waits. He gave us more spin about £1 billion NHS recovery, the national strategy. He talked about transformation. They're words not worth the paper they're written on. It's spin, statistical spin, yet again. But people see the reality on the ground. Deflection, whether it's Wales, Westminster or the pandemic. Cabinet Secretary, why don't we believe what you say anymore? Sandesh Gilhani described the First Minister or Cabinet Secretary. They come to the chamber, they make an announcement, they fail to deliver, then they defend their record by tripping out spin and promising lessons will be learned. If we just look at CAMHS, Humza Yousaf promised to deliver, he promised to clear CAMHS waiting times by March 2023, as Sandesh Gulhani said. And this does matter because poor mental health robs these children of their childhood. Jamie Green talked about the shocking and despicable lack of action on CAMHS waiting times, and he described 91 weeks in his constituency for a first appointment. Jamie Green also said, where are the Greens? I've noticed that two Greens have miraculously just turned up at near the end of this debate, but didn't listen to any of the debate. And Jamie Green talked about the creeping ineptitude in government. Bob Dorris said, not a single new idea is coming forward from anyone else. You've had 17 years, Bob Dorris. The SNP...
Through the chair, the always,
SNP
please.
The SNP say they have record staffing levels. The SNP don't like to hear the truth. The reality is that NHS has massive vacancies and high staff turnover. And Annie Wells described the failure to recruit more GPs and spending on agency staff has quadrupled in 2 years. There are over 5,000 nursing vacancies, she said, in NHS Scotland. And staff turnover is at its highest rate in a decade.
The member must conclude.
Presiding officer, Scotland deserves a fresh approach to deliver a modern, efficient and local NHS. But the stark reality is that while winter for the NHS is especially difficult, it is now condition critical for the health service all year round. 17 years of SNP mismanagement means the system is at breaking point and the buck stops at Bute House. And there's no one else to blame. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Jenny Minto, up to 4 minutes, Minister.
Officer, I want to start by thanking those that are at the heart of our NHS for their commitment, their hard work and their dedication. Without them, we would not be able to talk about building on recovery and delivering on our promises. We remain committed to driving down waiting times. We've increased investment in frontline NHS boards by more than £500 million in the draft budget, and we will continue to target resources to reduce waiting times, particularly for those waiting longest for treatment, through maximising productivity and additional resources. The Centre for Sustainable Delivery is working closely with boards to accelerate implementation of high-impact changes, including active clinical referral treatment and patient-initiated review, freeing up additional capacity in the NHS system and providing sustainable solutions for the future. With regard to delayed discharges, the winter plan for the NHS and social care for this year was published jointly between Scottish Government and COSLA, and it sets out a whole system approach to responding to the surge in demand for health and social care services which are experienced in the winter. It includes significant new funding measures to support the health and social system this winter, including £50 million to recruit 317 additional staff to Scottish Ambulance Service and an additional funding for hospitals at home. Delays with regards to the Scottish Ambulance Service, I do accept that there have been delays, but what we are doing despite these challenges, the Scottish Ambulance Service continues to maintain a fast response to the most critically unwell patients and divert cases away from A&E by safely triaging patients within their community whenever possible. I absolutely recognise that too many people are waiting too long for treatment, and the launch of our Waiting Well Hub gives people more information and tools they need to look after their health and well-being, to think about what matters to them and what health improvements they could make while they wait. With regard to mental health, which has been raised by a couple of contributors today, I think it's important to note that one in two children, that's 50% of children, are seen within 10 weeks. And 13 out of 14 of our health board CAM services have effectively eliminated their long waits. I think that's really important. I also want to be clear that under this Scottish Government, Scotland's NHS will always remain in the hands of the public and be free at the point of use. But make no mistake, privatisation from Westminster governments poses a real threat to Scotland's NHS. The Tories have always wanted to privatise the NHS, but now we have a Labour Party following suit. Unbelievably, with Labour's Shadow Health Secretary, Wes Streeting, said a Labour government would hold the door wide open for the private sector in the NHS. This matters for Scotland's NHS.
Let's hear the Minister.
By ramping up privatisation in England, the UK government is starving our NHS of investment. And if you need proof of that, look no further than the autumn statement, which shows a real terms cut to NHS England funding for 24-25 and doesn't provide even a single penny towards next year's NHS budget to pay for this year's pay deal. Even with the ongoing pressures, we've seen continued progress. In the last 3 years, there was an 11% increase in the number of planned operations compared to the previous 12 months. This demonstrates the continued post-pandemic recovery of Scotland's NHS. And I was very pleased to hear Ivan McKee specifically reference the fantastic research work for AI and also ANIA that is going on in Scotland. And that innovation will provide us with other ways forward. And the progress that we have made comes from our commitment to ensuring Scotland has a sustainable and appropriately skilled workforce. Work is well underway to ensure that we have sustainable workforce pipelines now and in the future. And let's look at this. Nursing and midwifery staffing is at a record high. We've got 8.4
qualified conclude, Minister.
Nurses and midwives per 1,000 of the population, and allied health professionals are at a record high of 34.1%. Presiding Officer, our NHS is
thank
our
you,
most
Minister.
Cherished,
you,
cherished
must, public. You must conclude. Thank you. And can I call on Paul Sweeney to wind up, please, up to 5 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The reason why Labour brought this motion to the Parliament today was because this waiting time scandal is unprecedented and it is one which comes up daily in our casework. And that is why we brought it here today, because you heard from the speeches here, I think we all did, Presiding Officer, that it is something that we all have skin in the game on. If it's not something that's affecting our own families, we will know someone who is languishing on that NHS waiting list. As Mr Smith raised, the tragic case of his constituent is just one horrendous example. I could rehearse several to the Chamber today if I had more time. And as we know that prevention is much better when we get in early, otherwise families spiral out of control and much greater harm is caused. That is what is compounding the problem facing us, with one in six Scots, over 860,000 of us, technically the biggest city of Scotland worth of people, languishing on that NHS waiting list. As my friend, the member for Dumbarton, newly invested as Dame Jackie, mentioned earlier today. And certainly the warm words from the Scottish Government cut little ice in this side of the chamber, Presiding Officer. The First Minister said in 2022 that the Government would seek to eliminate the longest waits in planned care, but around 80,000 people are still waiting over 1 year to be seen. And that has consequences. As the member, Ms Wells, for Glasgow said, 1,600 excess deaths estimated in A&E alone. This is severe and it is having serious effects on our population. Thus, that is why this is matter for debate here today. And with 7,000 Scots waiting over 2 years for treatment, as opposed to just 227 in England, I think it has been disingenuous in the extreme for members to come here and claim that COVID is the common denominator behind these matters. Certainly, COVID has had an effect, but it does not account for the extent to which the NHS in Scotland is not performing well enough. And it is completely unacceptable for the government to not take responsibility for that. They should stand by that record. Yes, happy to give way on that point.
Clare Haughey.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. Could you please clarify a couple of points that I raised in my speech? The Welsh Health Minister said COVID has had an impact on the NHS waiting times. Does he disagree with that? And does Scottish Labour support Wes Streeting in his calls to privatise the NHS?
Paul Sweeney.
I think we're probably, we seem to be in violent agreement, because I did accept the point that COVID has had an effect, but it does not account for the extent to which the NHS is in disarray in Scotland. And as for privatisation, I think that is a gross misrepresentation of the Labour Party position. And also, we want to look at the reality of what our constituents are telling us, Presiding Officer, because that's why we are here today, after all, not to moan about other parts of the UK, but to represent our constituents here in this place, to hold this government to account for its actions. And I'm afraid that having to choose one waiting list to prioritise if there are more than one, waiting over multiple years for surgery and countless cases of young people waiting over a year for mental health assessments is simply not acceptable. And indeed, some members of the government benches made constructive points. I refer to the member for Glasgow Proven, who raised the issue of digital spines for patient journeys. These are huge interventions we could be making to improve productivity in our NHS, but we're seeing capital budgets cut and efforts to improve efficiencies constrained. GPs tell us they simply don't have the headspace to even look at service reforms. Mental health is, of course, a serious concern. It's been raised by members today. The Scottish Government has failed to ever meet its target on waiting times for CAMHS, and the psychological therapies target has never been routinely met. Dr. Gulhani from Glasgow mentioned that, as did Mr. Green for West Scotland. I think these are critical points that have to be continually mentioned to the Government. The Government says that they are taking these weights seriously, but the mental health budget has been frozen and subsequently cut in year for 2 years running, and they are failing to meet their own target of 10% on NHS spend being allocated to mental health. And I think the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary, came to committee only this week and admitted that it's unlikely to be met by the end of this Parliament. It's simply not acceptable when, if that 10% commitment had been fulfilled over the last 3 years, almost £550 million more would have been invested into mental health services. Instead, we have a recruitment crisis that's costing us £567 million on bank and agency staffing. They have the cheek to come here and talk about privatisation when they're ploughing £500 million into private recruitment agencies. Presiding Officer, it's a sham. It's unacceptable. And as colleagues have referenced, the waiting times for cancer diagnostic tests is costing lives. People waiting well on a cancer diagnosis, I'm afraid they're dying waiting for treatment. That is what's happening in our midst here, and it is unacceptable on our watch. That is why we have brought this motion to the Chamber today, and that is why we commend it to this Chamber, and I hope that all parties will support it for the sake of Scotland's wealth and health, and ensuring that we have the best possible outcomes for our constituents.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on ending NHS long waits. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 11887 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 11887 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 11888 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on stage one timetabling for a bill. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. I call on Sandesh Gulhani. Up to 5 minutes, Dr. Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I wish to draw members to my register of interest as a practising NHS GP. The Scottish Parliament's Health Committee has discussed the SNP's befuddled plan to create a national care service at 21 meetings since June 2022. In May last year, meeting number 15, the perplexed Minister, Marie Todd, told us it was hard for her to get her head around the bill. This is the SNP flagship policy, a £2 billion policy, a policy that has been completely changed by Humza Yousaf. The policy is being rewritten as we speak, but the SNP will not let us see the actual wording of the policy before stage one's vote, almost certainly due to time pressure. We agree the bill needs further delay, but why not decide when the changes to the bill can realistically be completed, then use this to create a realistic timetable, allowing us to actually vote on a bill we can read and not guess at. Just as Minister Marie Todd said in May, today, nobody can get their head around this bill. Create a realistic timetable and a fair timetable for this Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Marie Todd. Up to 5 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am wondering, are the Conservatives really suggesting that we shouldn't proceed with the change that is so urgently needed in the sector? Because we all know that the case for change has been made unequivocally through the independent review of adult social care, through our ongoing co-design discussions with people with lived experience, and through almost every exchange I have with those working in and receiving services from the social work and social care sector. The case for change in social care is unassailable, and everyone agrees it's necessary. This is milestone legislation. It's the most ambitious reform of public services in Scotland since devolution. And this change is necessary to deliver the consistency and the quality of care and support across Scotland that people deserve. It's also necessary to reinforce our commitment to Scotland's people to take long-term action to change our society and make it a fairer place to live. We remain committed to delivering a national care service to improve quality, fairness and consistency of provision that meets individuals' needs. We know that the social care system in Scotland needs to change and that our partners across the public sector, including local government and the NHS, agree. We are working with people with lived experience and people who work in social care to provide what's needed. This is essential for a task of this magnitude. Now, we revisited our approach last year to do further engagement with people with lived experience and with COSLA and the NHS. We've been working really hard in discussion with numerous stakeholders through numerous regional events and meetings over the second half of 2023, certainly.
Jackie Bailey. I'm grateful to the Minister for taking an intervention. I wonder, given that you are delaying the process, whether you would seek this opportunity to put in place an external advisory board to help shape that revised legislation.
Minister.
So I think we have a clear idea of the legislation going forward, and I am more than happy to articulate that case to you right now. We've had weekly engagement between the Scottish Government, COSLA and the NHS since last summer. These weekly talks built upon the shared accountability consensus that was reached on the 30th of June last year and have created a proposal for a collaborative proposal for a revised version of the National Care Service. And subject to the will of the Scottish Parliament, the Scottish Government proposed to make amendments to the bill at stage two in response to evidence taken at stage one and ongoing feedback from stakeholders. Now, I believe our proposals for changing the bill at stage two are a highly reasonable and balanced proposition. They accommodate as far as possible the various stakeholders' positions while ensuring that we can still effect the real change and improvements that people using services today require and deserve. The Health Committee and the Finance Committee both asked for further information, which I provided in early December before Christmas, and I provided a substantial and robust package of material, including an updated financial memorandum and an updated business case. We are committed to working with the parliamentary committees. I have already committed to the lead committee to provide information on the Scottish Government's proposed amendments in a timescale that enables them to consider to the level that they're needed. I'm just closing. We are providing as much information as we can, as is appropriate in the parliamentary process, and will continue to do so.
Thank you. The question is that motion 11888 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motions. 11889 on stage 1 timetable for a bill and 11890 on a stage 2 timetable for a bill. And I ask any member who wishes to speak against the motions to press the request to speak buttons. And I call on George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motions.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm both moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motions. Therefore, the question is that motions 11889 and 11890 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motions are therefore agreed. And there are six questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that amendment 11875.2 in the name of Jenny Gilruth, which seeks to amend motion 11875 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy on Stand Up for Quality Education be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.